Lake Stanley. And this is the first demonstration of Roman nanotechnology from thousands of years ago. I'm not an expert on history like the previous speaker, but still. But before that, before we're talking about ancient stuff, I want to tell you a little bit about the Weizmann Institute. It's an institute of graduate schools in the exact science industry, life sciences, math and computer science, and science teaching. It was established in 1934. Again, not as old as Roman, but still somewhat older than modern university, by this man, Karl Weizmann, who was an organic chemist by training. He has about 150 patents, among other things that he has. And one of the great inventions that he did was some biotechnological development of acetone. They didn't call it biotechnology then, but this is what it was. And this was established in 1934 by a friend of Weizmann from England, and then later it was turned into what was known Weizmann named after him. This is the first building then, this is the first building today. This is his original lab. So if you come to the Hobart, you can still see classical organic chemistry lab from the 30s and 40s. Israel is fairly large. We have 2,500 employees, about 5 faculties, as I said. Chemistry and physics is where I'm more involved. And the budget is coming more or less in equal parts from the government directly, from research grants, and endowment of philanthropy, and income on intellectual property. So Weizmann was one of the early institutions to set up a wholly owned subsidiary for commercializing intellectual property. That was in the 60s. And now we enjoy substantial income, mostly on pharmaceutical, but also on mathematical and optical stuff. This is the budget. We have 250 research groups, 250 professors, about 1,000 students, 750 PhD and 150 master's students, and we have many postdocs and some unavoidable administration. And we're always looking for good students, so if you want to continue your studies on to the postdoc at Weizmann, write to us. Okay, so back to the Lycurgus cup. There was a beautiful paper quite some time ago of the discovery by Fristo. Discovery by Lycurgus is in the British Museum. But let's talk about the physics behind it. Okay, some more examples of beautiful stuff. These are the windows of Notre Dame Church in Paris. You ask yourself why it is there, it's because there are gold particles, there are quantum small gold particles in the glass, and if you change the size of the particle, we call it the quantum size effect. If you think of a wave function, you squeeze it, and then when you come to smaller particles, the color changes. So these are metal particles. The same thing happens with the semiconductor nanoparticles. If you make them smaller by any method you can, either mechanical or by chemical colloidal or synthesis or whatever, you get different colors depending on the size, and this became an art. You can make them pretty monodispersed, not perfectly monodispersed, but pretty monodispersed. You can control the spectrum by fairly simple chemical means, and we'll see later that you can do it by other means. So this is bottom-up synthesis of things which respond to color. The other beautiful things in nature, like this butterfly, and if you think about it, the blue color doesn't come from indigo or from any other pigment. It comes from these nanostructures in the wing of the butterfly. So somehow the butterfly, or whoever made the butterfly, knows that if you make these holes of a particular shape, particular spacing, and particular structure of the hole, you get the colors. And there are other colors, of course, not just light blue. Well, today, by focused ion beams and e-beam lithographies, tools that are available here. You can make, these are pictures of focused ion beam, you can make pretty much anything you want. When I say we, I mean my students, of course, I cannot. So you can make holes, you can make circles, you can make a line of holes, you can make shape, you can make whatever you want. Typical resolution are tens of nanometers, and you can normal focused ion beam, which is better. So these are the spacings here, are 50 to 100 to 200 nanometers. So you can make any shape you want. For the rest of the discussion, let's assume you can make anything you want. Not quite, but let's see. Okay. Another important discovery that came, I think 15 years ago, was this discovery by Thomas Edison, who found out that you can pass light through holes smaller than the wavelength. If I ask any of you, they have a wavelength of light, which is 1 micron. If they give you a hole, which is a tenth of that, 100 nanometers, how much light will go through? If I ask a child in high school, they would say, cannot go through because the wavelength is too long, it cannot go through a small hole. And actually the prediction is that by 15, the diameter of the hole is much smaller than the wavelength. The transmission goes like d over lambda to the fourth power. This was done only at the beginning of the last century. Very basic arguments. Let's calculate. If you have 1 micron wavelength, 50 or 100, say 100 nanometer hole, that's 10 to the fourth is 10 to the minus 4. So if you shine light on a screen with a small hole in it, you expect very little light to go through. And what Thomas Edison discovered is that when you shine light over it, whatever is going through is much, much more than the classical d over lambda to the fourth. Much more. So he answered, it took him 8 years to publish the paper, because we always like to publish things that everybody knows. This was unusual out of the box. Eventually it was published, and then it was explained in terms of plasmonic excitations in the metal. This would be a metal field. What is plasmonic excitation in metal? That's what we'll see in the next few minutes. So it has to be a metal field. If you take a carbon field or a wood screen, make a small hole, this will not work. Okay. Edison made a nice prediction there that these findings may find applications in novel photonic devices. That was 15 or 20 years ago. It's very, very right. Now, the transmission depends on the structure of the holes, if it's several holes. For instance, if you change the periodicity, for instance, then similar to the butterfly, then what you have is you have different colors going through because of various interferences of waves going through the holes. We'll talk about some of it again. Okay. So that was the introduction to the introduction. And now the introduction. What is plasmons? Plasmons, very simply spoken, are collective oscillations of electrons in a metal state. And this definition is enough. You put it in mathematical form, but you don't need it for this question. We have three kinds of plasmons. We have bulk plasmons. You take a piece of metal, it's clean enough, pure enough, etc., and you shine light on it, the electrons will move. And under certain conditions of frequency, they move collectively. So the electrons move together. They move together, of course, it's different than each one moving on its own. Then you have the localized surface plasmons, which I'll explain to you. These are the same thing, only when the bulk is not a bulk, it's a small particle. If it's a small particle, say a sphere, 50 to 100 nanometers, then the response is very different than when it is a bulk. And also, we'll see in a minute that these waves, oscillation of electrons is an electromagnetic wave, they can also propagate along the interface between the metal and whatever is next to the metal, be it glass or air or vacuum or silicon or whatever. But let's talk a little bit about specifics. Let's talk about these plasmons because these plasmons will be a major part of my talk. So imagine a little metal sphere. If you apply a voltage on it, the voltage pulls the electrons. For instance, they will go to the plus side. Very simple physics. I think this is exaggerated in the figure. They will not go half the diameter, but they go out of the sphere. What happens when you release the voltage? They go back. And they might oscillate a little bit. Now it happens that these oscillations for particles which are small enough happens to be in the optical frequency where we can see them. If you take a bulk and it oscillates, you don't see it, it's in a different frequency range. If you take a metal particle of the order of 1500 nanometers in diameter, those oscillations, these waves, happen to be in optical frequency. Therefore, we can access them with lasers, with detectors, with anything that measures optics. Okay. The type of oscillation, and therefore the type of optical response, depends on the shape. If this was a square, this was an elliptical. ellipsoid and this was an undefined shape, it would be very different than if it is a sphere. Also the size is important because you can imagine that inside the resonance takes time and the size makes a difference, for instance. So all these parameters of shape and size are important. I will not go much into the detail of that. And this phenomena gave rise to a phenomenon that might be familiar to many of you, surface enhanced Raman. It was discovered in the 70s that if you look for a Raman response of some molecule, you get a certain number. If you put it on a metal, which is properly prepared by corrugation, you can get a signal which is 1,000 or a million times stronger, surface enhanced Raman. It's very useful to look at molecule at small concentration. What is the effect? It was a big mystery at the beginning. It's this effect. If the surface is corrugated, suppose you have intrusion, you have oscillation of the electrons. If a molecule is sitting next to them, it sees a collective excitation of the electron, therefore it sees an enhanced response. Very impressive effect. And the last point I would like to make is the following. Normally, if you take the best microscope or the best lens in the focus light, you are limited by diffraction. To focus the light to the size of the region, which is on the order of the wavelength of the light, of the order of the micron, half a micron, or a micron, of the order of the wavelength of light. These guys are not limited because they are oscillations of electrons. They are not limited by diffraction, by optical diffraction. So in principle, you can focus light through these, and you get some local fields which are much smaller than the diffraction. It's nice if you want to do all sorts of diagnostics for nano anything. Okay, one word about the propagation of plasmons. If you solve Maxwell's equation on the sum of these for the metal, it's a fairly excitation, and you have the propagation of the wave propagating along the surface. And of course, if this is the metal and this is the other surface, it depends on what are the dielectric properties of the surface. Vacuum, glass, polymer, or whatever, and therefore the propagation velocity, the propagation length will be different. But basically, these are defined by the plasmon excited, as we discussed. And where is the field? The field is evanescent above and below, so it's really concentrated in a very thin layer at the surface. Could be deeper to the electric lower in the metal, but still, talking about nanometers. These are the propagating surface plasmons. And with this, I'm done with my introduction to introduction. And these are the topics I would like to cover more or less, depending on how much time. And if you have questions, go ahead and ask. We don't have to get to the end. Questions? All right. So let's talk about a simple case of coupled structure. So this is an experiment that was done some time ago. You take two metal discs, two gold discs, and you put them close to each other. This can be fabricated by the topography saying. The diameter is about 100 nanometers, 150 nanometers, and you change the distance between them here, from 10 nanometers to 250 nanometers. Typically, in the reality, it doesn't look so nice and round and symmetric, but it's not so bad. And what you do is you do two experiments here of the transmission and of the scattering. In two different light polarizations, one this way and one that way. One of them couples the oscillation. Because if you think about it, you move the electrons the way I described a minute ago. You move these electrons to the right and these to the right, and these two are moving together. So instead of having one particle, we have two operating together. So we expect this polarization to couple them. If they're moving this way, they hardly know of each other, so they don't know. And what we wanted to see here is how close is close, to what distances they feel each other. So you see that in 250 nanometer spacing, the two polarizations give more or less the same structure. So that means that 250 nanometer, quarter of a micron, these two particles do not know of each other. They work independently. As you go to 10 nanometer, the spectra are very different. So without going into the detail, why it is shifted, which way it is shifted, the spectra are very different, so the two know of each other. At what distance do they stop knowing each other? Somewhere here, 25, 80, 40, 50 nanometers. example, is of the earlier 39 we can see. These are particles. We decided to move into cavities. Now, there is a principle called a Binet principle, saying that you study in optics in the first year, and you have a screen with the hole, and just the material of the hole, and you add the two transmissions, you get one. So whatever is not going through the particle is going through the hole. Generally speaking, the classical result of many, many years ago. So we said, all right, and we saw the particles, let us look at the opposite. Let's look at cavities. So these are cavities in a thin metal field. These are the parameters. But it's not specific to these parameters. And what we did an experiment in nonlinear optics. Everything I will describe from now on, most of it is nonlinear optics, in the sense that you excite it in some frequency, and the material responds at higher harmonics. Second or third harmonics, but more proficient. Okay. So you shine light. One frequency, omega, and you observe the reflection. Light generated. You collect it back to omega. You can easily separate the two. And what do you see? You see that under this configuration, many holes, and you took many holes just for statistics, they are far enough apart not to talk to each other. What you see is a bunch of spots. You know the variation in intensity for various technical reasons, which I will not discuss. But you see that there are many, many spots, and each one of them responds basically individually. We studied the shape and the size, etc. We're not going into the detail. But you have response, second harmonic generation, from a single nanocavity. That's what you would have from a single nanoparticle. Okay. Next, we wanted to study coupling, because remember the headline is coupled nanostructure. So what we did the following experiment. We generated, in this case, three triangles. And to measure, or to see the complementary situation, we fabricated on the corpus hybrid exactly the same thing, only we left this standing and we cleaned everything else. So you had a particle, a pyramidal particle, same size, same separation, same everything. Size is about 200 nanometers on the side, and spacing is also 200 nanometers. So these two are complementary to each other. And if Babinet's principle is right, the result should be very similar. Okay. The trick is again to do it in two different polarizations. One along the axis and one perpendicular to the axis. So here is the result for the particle. This is perpendicular, this is along, ignore the polarization for now. And the results are not very good. There are no impressive differences between this polarization and that polarization. Which means, remember in the previous slide, that these particles are not really coupled. Okay, we go to the cavities. Look at this dramatic difference between this polarization is not supposed to couple them, and this one which is supposed to couple. The intensity is focused concentrated around the center. There is hardly any intensity there, relatively speaking. So that means that this polarization couples them very strongly. And moreover, we check the polarization and it's a clear dipolar emission, which is a clear signature. The dipole, so all these three work in unison, work together as a single dipole. Now, sometimes one of you has to ask a question. What is the question? All right, let me go back. The distance here is about 30 nanometer. We cannot count anymore. Told you here that these guys are about 300 nanometers, and yet they're coupled. So I'll help you. This is the question you want to ask. I taught you a minute ago that they couple only for 30 nanometer, and yet here they couple for 200, and they could have been much longer. What is the reason? And the reason is, and this will be a major building block for the rest of my talk, the reason is that we don't have a simple situation of Babinet's principle. What we have in the particles is the particle has a strong field in it, the field evanescently decays. Decays into vacuum, and that's it. That's the end of the story. It decays over 20, 30 nanometers. If there's anything there, it senses the field. If there's nothing there, because it's 200 nanometers away, no coupling, no sensing, nothing. What happens in the cavities? We have the excitation of the localized service possible, just as I had for the past. So the electrons are moving around the hole. But as the cavities are coupled by a metal field, these are holes in a metal field. The electrons in the metal, in the field. So the localized plasmons coupled to the other types of plasmons, propagating surface plasmons. So the localized excitation of the plasmons around the hole couples to long-range excitation in the metal field, in the interface between the metal field and the air cell. So now, the range of coupling is no longer the decay of the localized plasmons, but the propagation decay, propagation delay, propagation decay of those propagating surface plasmons. And this could be very good. This could be very good. So what you have is you have coupling through the propagating surface plasma. This is a very different situation. Fabinet's principle is not expected to apply, so we're not conflicting any basic law of physics, but it's a different situation that the cavities are different than the compartment. Why is it nice? Nice because it's very difficult to fabricate complicated structure on a 10 nanometer resolution. It's a lot easier to fabricate them on 100 or 200 or 300 nanometer, and therefore we have free room, we have free imagination to fabricate more complicated structure if we have this coupling. So this is the advantage of cavities in a metal film compared to particles. So for a while we'll play now with cavities, at the end we'll go back to particles.
Okay.
Yes.
Can we expect some quantum mechanical effects here, since we are talking about the overlap with functions of nanometers?
Okay. The convention, of course, quantum mechanics will work. The conventional wisdom is that if you're talking about sizes of 100 nanometers or so, you don't have to consider quantum mechanics. Classical optics, classical electrons, Maxwell equation work very well. What we do is we have a routine, either commercial or home built, to solve Maxwell's equation. It explains the data very well. By the time you go to a few nanometers,
but we should also consider the density of the metals. I mean, the metal we are talking about
here is classical. So this is classical computing. Again, if you go to very thin layers, suppose you put two of them on the top of the other, and you have 1 nanometer between them, people still use classical.
Yeah, I know that.
But the validity is questionable.
Yeah. But the
fact of the matter is that if you compare classical calculations way outside the region where they should be valid to experiment, more or less okay. By the time you come to, say, 1 nanometer or less, then it's a different story.
Is this long-range order coupling exist only on this triangle shape, or may it possible to enhance the...
Sorry, say it again?
The backside, please, on backside. Yeah, this is the last one that you are applying, that if we make a special structure like the triangle. So if you make a like a structure like not only triangle, but the square shape or pentagon or ring, so what will be this?
We play it also. Well, we started with triangles, the logic was that for second morning generation you need to make some symmetry. So we started with triangles, but we need squares, we need circles, we need all sorts. We need some chiral structure, anything more. This applies to all of them. The response of the individual one depends on shape, of course. Okay. What is Fourier mixing? I assume that everybody knows what Raman is. We have some level, some say vibrational level in the molecule. You send in a photon, and you get a photon which is smaller by this amount. You look at the spectrum, and you can learn about the spectroscopy of the molecule. Fourier mixing is a similar process. You excite with one photon, you wait either spontaneously or you stimulate down by a second laser to another level, and then you scatter another photon, and you observe the Fourier mixing frequency, 4 waves, 1, 2, 3, 4. And the Fourier mixing frequency is a 2 omega 1, you're taking two red photons in this case and 1 blue photon. So this is a well-known phenomenon. It's called CARS, it's called Fourier mixing under different situation. It has the advantage that you can tune your laser and you don't have to collect spontaneous photons, which sometimes is less sensitive. So you have control by using the lasers themselves. Okay. If you are not familiar with it, just take my word for it, an easy structure like this, and it depends on the frequency and the intensity of what you're managing. So the exercise, what we wanted to do here, is to look at metal fields with very simple, in answer to your question, very simple rectangular holes, and try to ask ourselves, what is the best shape of the holes and the array of holes to give us the maximum for wavelengths? These are the frequencies we chose. How do you normally do molecular spectroscopy? You have a molecule. This is how the molecule was created. You tune your laser to the molecular line, to this line, combination, because you cannot change the molecule. Here is the opposite situation. We chose a laser, and when we change the structure, we will fabricate, calculate and fabricate the structure that matches our laser. So it's exactly the opposite of what you do in molecular spectroscopy. So the question is, how do we change these structures to match our frequency? Okay, so we chose from the beginning to change one parameter. There are many parameters you can change. We chose to optimize only one parameter, the aspect ratio, the length of the width of each triangle. The number of triangles is fixed, the spacing is fixed, the thickness is fixed, everything else is fixed. You only change a single parameter. So we can understand the physics. Okay, these are the parameters. And what you do is first you calculate the spectrum. It can be done, you solve Maxwell's equation. You can calculate the spectrum. So one of them is calculated, one of them is measured. And what you have here is just the ratio going from 1, which is the square, which is the area of the rectangle, and this is the spectrum. What do you see? That for a square, we have one peak. As you start to make it more elongated, we have two peaks. One that hardly changes in frequency, and one that changes significantly as you change the aspect ratio. Okay, these are plasmonic resonances in the metal. I can go into detail what exactly they are, but it's not important. For different cavities, we have different spectra for the proper polarization. So I'm showing three cuts in this complicated three-dimensional picture, one at the aspect ratio of 1, 1, 2, and one somewhere near 3. And this is what you have. This is for aspect ratio of 1. Sorry, this is for 1, this is for around 2, and this is for around 3.7. Okay. Now if I ask you which would give the best forward vision, the best Raman response to this frequency, of course, the one that is resonant at 800, because from 800 we take 2 photons, so it goes the intensity of that frequency squared. And therefore, we expect that out of these three spectra, this one, which is aspect ratio of 2.1, will give the strongest four-wave mixing response. And indeed, if you measure the four-wave mixing, this is the predicted one, this is the experimental one, and it behaves nicely and gives you the right enhancement. And it's not a trivial enhancement, it's an enhancement of more than an order of magnitude. So if you just take a trend of a bunch of cavities, you get something, say if you take squared, if you play this optimization, you can improve by an order of magnitude. Nice, we're happy with it. And then we ask, the next question is, why limit ourselves to only one parameter? One parameter, we would more or less see the physics of what we're doing. But the other parameters, there is the area of each rectangle. There is the separation, X and Y, between the rectangles. There is the film thickness. So there are about 4, 5, 6 parameters that you can play with. How do you play with it? We chose to do genetic algorithm search for optimization. I don't know if you're familiar with it. It's the way that you start with the random collection of parameters. Iteratively, you will improve your selection. We will discuss it later if you wish. And we optimized all of them. So this was a master's work, master's student work. And what we found out is that for this set of parameters, it doesn't matter what they are, you get 3 peaks. If you remember, that's 3 relevant frequencies that I had a minute ago. Anyway, that 3 frequencies, one around 800, one around 650, and one around 1100. And what we could by optimization, get exact matching, so this is in the limit of molecular spectroscopy, significantly stronger than the original one. So this is another order of magnitude improvement compared to the simple optimization of only one component. Again, this is possible only because the coupling between the cavities are stretches for a long distance. If it was 10 nanometer, 20 nanometer, it would be impossible to design in this way. So what you do is you sit at the computer, you optimize it, go to the field, fabricate it, usually come back and give the result. It's not as simple as that, but it's pretty impressive because you can plan by this mathematical optimization the shape that you want, and the fabrication of the thing is not that accurate, could be 10, 20 nanometer off, but by and large you get what you get. And this is, as I said, significantly higher than what we started with. Okay. There's another factor which is very important that we discovered as we went along. These are pictures of the field inside the cavity. So this is the film thickness from here to there. The cavity is here in between, and this is a plane wave of light propagating through the cavity. And what you have is you have, the field is strong in some cases. Let's try to but what you have is you have the two nodes at 645 and 800. They don't overlap in terms of where within the nanometer region where they are the strongest. So again, you might ask whether the classical calculation is correct in this range. We don't know, but the result gives nice distribution of the field. In one case, in the center of the cavity; in the other case, in the edges of the cavity. And this is another factor that we have to take into account to optimize this. Okay, so this was chapter one, where we try to optimize a nonlinear response. Now we try to talk about the phase, and I haven't mentioned the word phase so far at all. There's quite a bit of earlier work, especially by Federico Capasso, Parma, before the Sassman, and many, many others. And what you need to know, what's important to know, again, without going into fancy mathematics, is that when you have a resonance and you shift it, one of them is the absorption, one of them is the phase, of course, changes very, very significantly between this point and that point. And what you've done is you've shifted the resonance of scaled wavelength. In plasmonics, we shift the resonance by redesigning the structure. So that means that if I design two structures, one resonance here and the other one resonance there, I will affect the phase response of the material to light excitation. And this is what we're going to use in what follows for this type of a process. Okay. Let me remind you of some very nice optical phenomenon which is called Snell's law, which has to do with the phase of light. Here is a lifesaver, and here is a guy probably drowning. And of course, what the lifesaver wants to do is to save this drowning person. This is sand, and this is water. The lifesaver can run here and has to swim there. So the speeds of progress are very different. This is from the internet. And what the lifesaver, because he knows physics, he looks at these different structures, and he knows that this would be his best way to get there fastest, because he sort of optimizes the choice between a shorter distance or a longer distance, but then here is faster than there. Turns out that this is in between, and this way will get him fastest to the drowning person, maybe even second. Sometimes the situation is more complicated, and this gives rise to Snell's law, which again we started in. Sometimes there is an obstacle. So suppose there is deep sand there, or mud, or something with, again, a different velocity altogether. So what you did before, that you ran this way, and then that is not applicable anymore because you have three velocities. So let's see what he chooses now. So you go in the mud, you waste some time in the mud, and then you go. And because it's much more difficult to cross the mud, it makes sense to run a longer way. much longer, a higher velocity, and then cross over. Now, this corrects to a corrected or generalized Snell's law, read by a professor in this paper, which adds a d phi dx factor, depending, of course, on the thickness of this erodic crystal. So you just propagate it through the prism. And you generate, in our world of plus one is, you generate a layer of antennas, which I will not talk about, but this is how it was done in the original paper. What did we do instead? We looked at a picture similar to what I showed you a few minutes ago, of the intensity, the frequency, versus the aspect ratio. This was intensity. These are the two modes that we discussed before. Only intensity. What about the phase? And the phase can be calculated, and this is the phase. This is the phase of the light going through the structure as we are changing the input parameter. And what you see is, again, the absolute numbers are not important, but you see that there is a large difference in phase between one and one. There is a 2-pi phase difference at the different structure. If you can control the transmission, and you can control the phase, you have full control of the light that goes through. And therefore, what you can do these are the relevant frequencies that we are discussing. And what you can do is you can generate a prism by changing an array of cavities where the dimension of the cavities are different. So this will have one phase, different phase, and this is the aspect. So this is the aspect ratio. And what you have is you see that you're coming in with a plane wave, and then you have a tilted wave because the wave is going sideways, similar to going through a prism. So this is the equivalent, or the plasmonic equivalent, of a prism of glass or sand or whatever. And when you do that, let me go quickly through that, what you have is you have the phases of the individual ones, and the forward mixing generated phase then has a correction. And if before the propagation was straightforward, the propagation now will be at the angle, and this is exactly the same phase, only a nonlinear version of the generalized Snell's law. And what you have is you can control by controlling the properties this field, you can control the direction of propagation, which is really nice because you can control the phase now of the wave as it propagates. That enables you to have the forward mixing, and it's a non-linear process, and the light can go in any direction that you want. So here is you change some parameter, and the light is being diverted to a different direction. Of course, if you have this capability, you can design lenses. You can design a distribution of phases that's similar to the glass lens, and what you have is you have, say, a lens that focuses light tens of nanometers away from tens of microns away from the surface, or other lenses you can have, different lenses, and these are again lenses which are not glass lenses, but they are very thin films, 200 nanometers thick, of metal with holes in it, and depending on the phase distribution, you can have these lenses. And no, this is because I'll come back to that idea. Okay.
Did you notice here any kind of nonlinearity? Because this kind of gradient will create force for the plasmas.
The what you refer to the force or momentum is this extra momentum that is given through the wave.
It would be like squeezed.
In principle, if I could measure very sensitive motion of the film, I should see it, but it's impossible. It's similar to any nonlinear crystal. We have extra momentum given to the light, but the crystal is bulk, and therefore the amount of momentum given to the crystal is the same as to the light, but it's anything. There's a mechanical effect on the crystal. It's the same, same as any nonlinear crystal. Okay. Moving to the next thing that you can do with this structure, which is nonlinear metal material and holography. Okay. In an earlier work, quite a few people were from Europe and the US and China. And this time we V-shaped particles for various reasons we chose them. And what you change is change the length and the width and the angle. If you want to keep it symmetric, there are ways to keep it asymmetric because these arms will be different and better. So let's talk about length and angle. You can, again, you can calculate the spectrum, calculate and measure the spectrum, and you see a spectral shift depending on the change of parameters, similar to what we saw with the parameters of the rectum. So this is the spectrum, and these are the same figures that I've shown earlier for the rectum, somewhat more complicated, density in phase, and basically, the take-home message from this figure is that you can design any phase and intensity that you want, you can choose the right parameters of length and angle and have this response. You have the full 2-pi range, which is what you need to have full control of the phase of the light. Okay, so this one. And here is how you do the multilayer heating deposition. This is a nano center. It took us quite a while to develop this. The end, when you know how to do it, it's very simple. Nobody even thinks you deposit one layer and then you deposit the second and the third, but it's not so easy for the following reason. When you deposit the first layer, you need to put the insulation layer above. If you're not careful, the second layer will be deformed. It will go, take the shape of the first one. By the time you go to the second or third, the whole surface is distorted and you cannot really control exactly what you want to have. So instead, what my postdoc, Eugenius Almeida, did was the following. You start by depositing the mass that you want, and you deposit the gold inside those cavities. And then what you have is you have gold above the resist, and you wash away the upper gold, and you have a flat surface. Once you have a flat surface, you're equivalent to the beginning of the cycle and you can start again. So the trick was to deposit the first one not on the surface but in the surface. In retrospect, it should have been triggered. And then you can go back and do the second layer and whatever you want. If you have multi-layer stuff, you can do that. And the accuracy is controlled by some markers on the side. I'm giving you the detail because this is a nanocenter and sometimes it's important. The accuracy is on the order of 10 the overlay. Natural levels of 10 nanometers, which is a nice result, good enough for us. These particles are about 100 nanometers in size. Okay, so we have multilayers. What can we do with it? So here is an element, and I'll show you a few examples of elements of what you can do with multilayers. So these are V-shaped antennas, on purpose, move relative to one another, because for this application, it's not important for the other. One is designed for one polarization, design for the other polarization. So this one, this is the original light. This one shifts the light this way, and that one shifts the lights this way. Just by controlling, and it's a single element. If you want to do it with classical optics, you need several optical elements which are fairly large and bulky, and you have also for distortion. So this is a single plate, a wave plate if you want, that switches the light. Basically, it's a breaker. Okay, here's another one showing a lens. This is a fraction of the lens because it will have this structure. But again, it's different design. We put the two layers, one on top of the other. And those two lenses are designed differently such that for different polarizations, they focus the light differently. So you have a lens, you shine this polarization, you get, 500 micron focal length, and you shine this polarization, you get 1 millimeter, or any number that you want to design. Not so good. Okay, if we can control the phases of individual pixels, this is the first chapter in holography. What is holography? In a normal photograph, we record intensity. In a hologram, we record intensity and phase, then you illuminate again, and you recapture a three-dimensional image of your object. Okay, well known for many, many decades. So this is an artist concept of a multi-layer, where each one of them, of course, can capture the phase that you want to imprint with. So these are computer-generated holograms. You cannot take a picture and generate a gold structure, not yet. But what we can do is we start in the image. The point on the image is a source wave going to the screen. We add all the waves coming from each point, whatever resolution you want, on the image, and then you get the hologram. This is how it looks at the face of the hologram, the face of the screen. So you have funny shape. This is a high face, low face, middle face, etc. Doesn't carry any information. Similarly, to look at, if you, this looks still numerical, this looks right. If you look at the light propagating through it to reconstruct the image, this is what you see. Not so bad for the introduction. I want to emphasize, you know, an hologram that you buy on the street or that you do in the lab. Suppose you're doing with the helium neon laser, with the red laser. The hologram was generated, you illuminate it with the red laser, and the image is formed with the red laser. The image is formed at the same frequency that you illuminate. Here what we did, we chose a situation, we chose those elements, not only to maintain the phase, but to generate the third harmonic. So we shine in omega, and we get 3 omega. So we shone in infrared light at 1200 nanometers, and we got the hologram generated at 400 nanometers. This is a non-linear hologram. Why is it good? It's good because you don't have any scattering of the generating atoms. So the hologram is much, much cleaner than before. So this is what I say here. The image is formed at the new wavelength. And here are some pictures. This is, in this chart, is considered to be a demonstration of a three-dimensional image because different images are formed at different distances. In principle, if you had many layers, not two or three, you can have as many layers. For instance, it's very difficult to do. You can have many layers in the future, and then you can have a three-dimensional image being reformed. Okay, and there are some games you can play. Here there are 3 layers, each one of them for different polarization. And when you play with it, you can have dynamic polarization. If you rotate, okay, it doesn't work. If you rotate your polarization, the image is changed. So this is a holographic movie. Again, this is the third harmonic, so this is UV for infrared incoming light. Okay. And then we wanted to see the resolution, so we chose some famous figures from Picasso, and we wanted to see the resolution. And the resolution that I am using in order to choose a few of my ones, which is nice. this is at the wrong surface, at the right surface. Really reconstruct the images. This is another example of 3 chrome elements. And this is the artist concept of what you can do. And I must tell you that when the paper was accepted in the journal, we ran into a problem because the editor saw this Dove of Peace from Picasso, and the image of Picasso said, fine, the paper is accepted, the physics is okay, but you need to get permission from the Picasso Foundation to use this figure. Right? Picasso Foundation in Spain. Go ahead, get the permission. No problem, take 5 years. We switch it and we put a fish there and it's okay. Okay, so to remind you of these 3D materials, and I'm pushing the end of my talk, this is a device that we generated. That's the last work that we've done so far. And what you have is you have image concept of 3 layers, each one of them designed differently. I showed you how you can do with different layers. What I'm not showing you is that these different layers, this one is made with gold, this one with silver, and this one with aluminum. Why would we do that? Because you want to have those 3 layers for the different colors. So this is what you see is an RGB achromatic lens. As you know, this projector is showing you the full color. It has only 3 colors in it, R, G, and B. The lens there needs to focus all 3 colors out of the screen. It's a complicated lens. It has, I don't know, 30 or 27 elements or something because of chromatic aberration. Each color is focused differently by the lens. This little device, the whole thickness is 3,400 nanometers, was designed in such a way that this layer made of gold is optimized for red light, this one for silver, optimized for green, etc. And we have 3 layers, each one focused at a different distance such that the total bright light of three colors coming from here is a spectrum, can focus up without any chromatic aberration. And this is shown here. This is a normal metal surface lens with, you cannot read the numbers, but this is 1 millimeter, this is 0.75, and this is 1.25. So a millimeter or two of propagation distance, the aberration distance, is very significant. Whereas this particular lens is hardly aberrated at all, and we can have images of it going to model. Okay. Take-home message, the summary of this and what you expected to remember, what I hope you will remember, is that the metal film cavities, or cavities in metal film, coupled from longer distances, and the surface plasma propagates into the membrane on both sides of the metal film. I'm going to show you any proof of that. The four-way mixing for the second ammonia generation, or third ammonia generation, any nonlinear optical responders can be optimized. Can be optimized without thinking by plugging into the equation and optimizing by genetic algorithm, other optimization search mechanism, and you can get decent results, and of course you have to understand that the optimization is there. And it's not trivial to not a factor of two, it could be orders of magnitude. So if anybody is going to use these devices, they better optimize them. You have phase control, which can give you a computer generated model run. And with this new element, the RGB and the spectrum blending, etc., I would like it to be used for the next generation of fiber. Think about it, that you can make these elements at the end of a fiber, for instance. And if you do any intra-body detection, any color detection, you can have it right in the fiber. I can think of a dozen other applications with the capability of making optical elements of your choice. Very small size and very small thickness could be very useful. People who did the work, this is a postdoc, Vitor Salmina from Brazil, who's moving to New York at the end of this year. He's now moving to the group right now, he's recently graduated, he's an author, he's an open, and the RGB lens of study collaboration for people with people at Tel Aviv University. There's a whole section of theory with Maxim Kamal and others. I didn't describe. The theory in principle is Maxwell's equation. So in principle, you can plug in the equation and solve, and that's the end of the story. Of course, you don't learn much. So you need a lot of theoretical analysis, especially with Maxwell's survival, to understand the physics of the interaction. There's a whole bunch of work which I didn't describe of what happens when you put molecules on these metal surfaces. The picture of the Weizmann Institute, I want to thank you for that.
Change because they are adhered to the surface and they're not changing that much.
So the fact that my plasmonic response is limited, is sensitive to the first nanometer or two, makes it very difficult. The liquid crystal turn out to be not very effective. So people use charge accumulation, people use nonlinear optical effects. But yes, if you can control the dielectric function from the outside, you have a dynamic system. And that will be great because it's not just the dielectric function that you're changing, say, reflection or transmission, you're changing the whole plasmonic. And there is light by light switching, and there are many other ideas that are floating around that will change because of the dielectric function. One comment that should be mentioned is the following. All these are metastructures. The field of plasmonics, which is very, you know, just at the conference in Taiwan, 10,000 people, it's a very active field. But people are realizing that the metals are not the optimal material. The metals are lost. The gold is nice, but it's lossy eventually. There is absorption in the gold. It is gold. So people are trying to move to either dielectric, silicon, or silicon nitride, or some other materials, or combination of gold and dielectric function. This is in the beginning. So probably 5-10 years from now, where we give a talk about plasmonic structures, will be a combination of metal and dielectric. So, excite them enough at the proper frequency, you may have some, but it's not the same as when you say that's exactly the problem. So people have different structures, they see different resonance and motion, and they doubt them, but it's not simple. So there is no clearance, there is no immediate replacement for the metallic plasmonics.
This is much more simple. There are holes, you can feel this hole, something can flow through this hole.
Yeah, we did some early experiments, but many calculations of what happens if you put material in the hole. If it's not vacuum, it's not air, you put material, you can put molecules, and then you get resonance enhancement because those say, molecules may have, if you choose them properly, if you design the structure properly, they will have a resonance right at the right frequencies. For instance, the experiment that we're trying to do now, we have a triangle. We put little blobs of material, either quantum dots or simple molecules, near the edges or in the center, to try to map the response of these plasmonic structure. The enhancement is very significant because of this reason. Yes, this is the
I was curious about the lifetime of the plasmons. So I guess that work is not through, but continuously.
Both continuous and nanosecond pulses.
Because if it is pulsed, I guess some more nonlinearity would be generated in the system.
Like what?
Like superluminescence or
I'm sure
especially because of the cavities.
I'm sure it may happen. The luminescence would have very long emission time, so we will not see this is active, this is forward mixing. Some of it is done with short pulses, and therefore we are completely immune against those other effects. Sometimes it's a disturbing effect because you see phosphorescence, you see luminescence, you have what we call junk that you want to get rid of.
Yes,
it's not, and people have looked at it, people have looked also at enhanced cavity effects, and we are not looking at it. They should be. For the femtosecond pulses, nothing, none of that is ready.
Thank you for a nice talk. You had shown that nanocavity is not transparent coupled for larger distances. And I want to ask that, what is your expectation for 2D structures like graphene?
Like graphene?
Yes.
Okay, graphene is an interesting case because it has electrons. People are using plasmonic excitations in graphene to create in layer. Of a measurement of people measuring the propagation distance. I'm sure it has been measured, I'm not aware of it. It will probably be somewhere in between. It will not be as bad as vacuum or dielectric. It will probably not be as good as gold. Probably, my guess is something in between, but I do not know of a specific measurement that I can put. But people are trying to do as a solution for these properties, the absorption of the metals to work with graphene. Plasmonic excitation in graphene, a layer absorbed only about 2%, 1.5%. So so it has a potential. So far, it's exotic experiments, but it's a very active job. It's a very good direction.
For detection gas or liquid medium, maybe.
So people have used plasmon, surface plasmon resonance detection. What they do is they excite some plasmon, say, on a piece of glass, and they put it in some material because, as we said, the dielectric properties are different and the resonance moves. Yes, this you can buy. So this is done. What we do here is something which we are trying to develop is to have specific response to a specific material or specific frequency. And one work which I did not describe is a problem I posed to one of my students, and that is the following. Suppose you have two spectral lines or two molecules, one with the line here and one with the line there. I would like my plasmonic sensor to see only this one. If I look at any of the resonances of the shapes that I showed you, it's very broad compared to say 50 nanometer or 30 nanometer separation of two adjacent, and let's say this is 30 nanometers. So the goal of the exercise was, let us look at our genetic algorithm, an evolutionary algorithm of designing the shape. It starts from a given shape of say a triangle, and try to develop a plasmonic response that looks like that. So for instance, the amplitude here divided by the amplitude there should be maximized. And I can tell you that we started from a triangle, And we ended up with something like this. Why? I have no idea. But this gave, not quite this, but something like this. Factor of about 20 or 30 in resolution. So there is hope there. There's a lot more, but we need to understand it. This is not, we can fabricate it. But this is not something I'm happy with because I want to understand the response. But yes, it's possible to have sensing capabilities which are specific, not just enhanced, and not by shifting of resonance, but selecting. You want to see molecule A and not to see molecule B. It has a future.